Well, howdy, everybody. My name is Dave, and I want to say thank you for joining us today. Great Lakes Church has not shut down yet. We are still going strong, and you want to know why? Because we are an essential business. We are absolutely essential. I know everybody wants to claim that they're essential, but I want you to know we are really essential. I just felt like saying that. So here's the deal, guys. We are going to start today by doing something a little dangerous. We're going to live on the edge. I am going to ask you to play a game with me. All right? Now, it's a little living on the edge because God only knows what can happen when you haven't practiced anything. Since we're not in the same room, I just need you to find the comment section either below you or on the side of you. If you're watching at a time where we're premiering one of our services, and we are going to play the game catchphrase. If you've never played the game, what happens is when I press start, a category will come up. I'll tell you what category it is. Then I will start the timer, and I'm just going to start firing off different phrases and different words to try to get you to say whatever word is on the screen. All right? So get ready to put some comments in. I want you to be fast as lightning. We'll see how smart you are. The category that we're going to start with is going to be the category everything. All right, we are going to go for everything, and we're going to get started right now. Here we go. You read this. An author puts this together. I'm not even going to give you any more clues, right? That was a book. All right, here's this next one. It's two words. Not vegetable, but, and it comes in the form of like Little Red Riding Hood carried one of these. All right, two words. Fruit basket. All right, so this next one, be right in the comments, two words. It's not vanilla. It's the opposite of vanilla. And it's something you would put into cereal if it was just plain, right? You can drink it. It does a body good. Chocolate milk, all right? Here's this next one. It's just one word. Necklaces are made of them. Oyster, the answer would be pearl. Guys, I'm sure you are doing a brilliant job in keeping up. But here's why I do this. I am curious that if you're playing this game with family and friends and the word gospel came onto the screen, I'm curious what words, what phrases would you use to try to get everybody to say the word gospel? Now, of course, some of you would be like, I'm out, right? I can't even play. I don't know how to describe that. Others of you, maybe if you have a little bit of background of reading the Bible or maybe going to church, maybe you know that the word gospel means good news. So you would say, well, it's the good news that Jesus taught. And you would just cross your fingers hoping that everybody would know what that meant. But I really want to ask this question. What is the good news that Jesus taught? What is the gospel message that Jesus proclaimed? Now, if we were doing a Zoom format and everybody could just shout out their answers, that would be pretty fun. I'm guessing the answers would be all over the map. You know, some would reference teachings of Jesus. Some would reference maybe interactions Jesus had with people. Some would maybe reference the crucifixion, the death and burial of Jesus. Maybe someone would reference the resurrection of Jesus. But here's the deal. There is a very specific message that Jesus repeated over and over and over throughout his teachings. Just a very short phrase that if he were giving this teaching today, he could just tweet it out. In fact, Matthew, who was one of his disciples, he records Jesus using this phrase. Here's what Matthew says. He says, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Mark, who was a close friend of the disciple Peter and learned a lot about Jesus through Peter, he records the words of Jesus this way. The kingdom of God is near. Repent of your sins and believe the good news. Luke, who was a physician, a very educated man, he researches the life of Jesus and he records Jesus saying this, the kingdom of God is near. John, another disciple of Jesus, he records an interaction that Jesus has with a religious leader who comes to Jesus in the middle of the night seeking truth. And Jesus says to him, I tell you the truth, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, if we had to summarize the message of Jesus, and we had to explain the word gospel in just a couple words, it would be totally appropriate for us to use this phrase, the kingdom of God. So let me ask this question. What is the kingdom of God? Now, if you're watching this talk, in one of our morning premieres on Sunday. I know that's a lot of brain power that you got to use, right? I know you want to go refill up with coffee and try to get your brain firing on all cylinders. I get that. But it's a very important question for us to consider. What is the kingdom of God? Now, for me to ask a question like that is like me asking, well, what is your favorite vacation spot? Like, what is your dream vacation? All of us are going to have different answers. Some people will say, well, the dream vacation would be a cabin in the mountains surrounded by beauty and nature. Matter of fact, if you're watching at a time where we're premiering right now, why don't you give a like or maybe a heart? And if that's your favorite type of vacation, is being up in the mountains in nature, just go ahead and let us know that. But others of you, right, your dream spot vacation would be finding a home on the beach, a lake house, maybe a home on the ocean. You just want to be out in the sunshine. If that's you, let us know with a heart, with a like. Just stay engaged here. Now, there are others of you who your dream vacation is just to stay busy all the time. You don't like being bored. So you would want to go to a tourist destination, Gatlinburg, Orlando, Eau Claire. You want a place where you can just stay busy with your family and friends. So if that's your kind of vacation, tourist spot, just go ahead and you can give a like. And then there are mothers with young kids at home all the time. And your dream vacation, some of you, is just to go to the grocery store without your kids and to take your Starbucks cup and empty it out and put wine in there instead and just walk around the grocery store as long as possible. And if that's you, we do not judge you. But all of us, if we had to talk about our dream vacation, would have different images come to our mind based on our background or preferences or personality. And I think that is exactly what happens when we talk about the kingdom of God, right? When we hear that phrase, because each of us has a different picture that comes to our mind. Some of us have this picture of this magical kingdom up in the sky with unicorns and clouds and cotton candy and rainbows, right? This place that we get to go when we die someday. And I understand that. And then there are others who, for you, the kingdom of God is a political empire. If we could just elect evangelicals into places of power in our city and state and nation, oh man, we will be saved from impending doom. And then there are those who you picture the kingdom of God as a community of people that look and talk and act alike. You know, during the 18th and 19th centuries, there were lots of utopian societies that started to form in the United States. And one of the most successful societies that started to form was started by a guy named John Humphrey Noyes. And in 1848, he sets up a community in New York State in a town called Oneida. It became known as the Oneida community. And as respectful as I would like to be, they believed a lot of weird things, right? One of their beliefs was that once you became a follower of Jesus, you entered a state of sinlessness and perfection. Now, obviously, they never met Pastor Justin from our Kenosha campus, right? Or they would have changed their beliefs pretty quickly. Another one of their beliefs was they believed in complex marriage, which means that every guy in the community was married to every woman in the community. So everybody was kind of married to each other, just bizarre. And they lived in this 93,000 square foot mansion. So 300 people living together as one family. And they supported themselves in numerous ways. They did farming, blacksmithing, several different ventures. But their most successful venture was making silverware. They started a silverware company called Oneida Limited. And it still exists to this day. Matter of fact, whenever I buy plates or silverware, whenever my wife buys this stuff, right? We'll always buy just an extra set so that if we lose some of the pieces, if some of the glassware or some of the dishware breaks, right? We have some replacements. So when we bought a silverware set several years ago, we actually bought another set. And I went down and looked at it and sure enough, Oneida. It's just pretty fascinating that this company that was started by this utopian society still exists. But after 30 years, they disbanded. And of course they disbanded because this idea that we can just all live together and be free from the problems and the pain and the temptations and the sin that's in this world is an illusion because all of that stuff is inside of us. We can never really escape it. Now, here's what's interesting. When Jesus talks about the kingdom of God, He does not talk about this invisible place up in the sky, and he doesn't talk about a political empire, and he doesn't reference some utopian society. Instead, he talks about it in a very different way. On one occasion, he's surrounded by a crowd of people who are obsessed about the same things, quite honestly, that a lot of us get obsessed with. They're obsessed with their health. They're obsessed with money. You know, how can I make more money? How much house can I afford? They're obsessed with what are some of the things that are going to happen in the future. Like we're worried about things. And Jesus, listen, your heavenly Father knows what your needs are. He knows what your desires are. But then he says this. He says, seek the kingdom of God above all else. Seek the kingdom of God above all else. Seek it more than anything else. For followers of Jesus, so if that's you, the primary pursuit of your life ought to be the kingdom of God. Now, as Americans, this can be an abstract concept, right? Because in our culture, we don't talk a lot about kingdoms, unless we're watching Game of Thrones or playing Risk or maybe Settlers of Catan. We don't think in kingdom terms or use kingdom language. But in the first century, the concept of kingdoms was a cultural reality. People lived under the rule and reign of a monarchy. So there were kings, there were queens, there were royal heirs, there were subjects, there were empires, and everybody understood the concept of kingdoms. Now, even though we don't saturate ourselves in this idea of kingdom terminology and kingdom language and all this stuff, we can understand it. Because the reality is this, everybody has a kingdom. Everybody has a kingdom. Whenever you have control of something, we all control something, right? We all control or have power and influence over something. Whatever that is, that's our kingdom. Your kingdom is wherever you rule and reign. So I could say, well, my body is a kingdom. I determine what I eat. I determine what I watch. I determine what I say. I determine when I go, where I go. I determine all that stuff. Children have a kingdom. That's not a big kingdom. Most of it can just fit into a toy box. But they still have a kingdom. They've got Legos and videos and different games. Maybe they have a bedroom, right? For them, that's their kingdom. And the thing about our kingdom is we all want to be in charge of our kingdom. We don't want anybody telling us what to do, which is why the favorite word of a two-year-old is what? It's no. What's the second favorite word of a two-year-old? Mine. Okay, that is kingdom language. Now, when I was growing up, my family, every summer, would go to Rice Lake, Wisconsin. So we'd go from Kenosha to Rice Lake, which is five, maybe 6 hours. And we'd all be excited. But of course, a couple hours into the trip, we'd start to get restless. I mean, there were seven of us kids. There were six boys and one girl. And so we'd just start getting annoyed with one another. And inevitably, at some point, one of us siblings would draw an invisible line in the seat and just say to the other who is next to us, like, this is my space, right? Don't cross that line. But because we are siblings, we would irritate one another. We'd take our finger and we'd push it over the line. And what we were trying to do is say, hey, I need to be in control of something. And as we would fight and argue, my parents would get involved and they'd have to govern these different kingdoms that were out of control. And my mom would get so annoyed, right? Eventually she would say, like, guys, I just want peace and quiet. Can we just play the quiet game? And I'd be like, Mom, I'm 18 years old. I'm not playing the quiet game. But here's the deal. We all have spaces in our life. We all have areas in our life that we want to control. And when we're kids, we have that space. But then what happens is we get older and we have more space, right? You're a teenager, you have more freedom, you have more influence, you have more possessions. As adults, man, this is my house and it's my rules. I get to do what I want. It's my TV. I paid for that. I'm going to watch what I want to watch. It's my fridge. I'm going to drink what I want. I'm going to eat what I want. And so this whole idea of kingdom is built into who we are as humans. And we see it evidenced even all the way back at the start of creation when God looks at the two first human beings that were ever created, and he says to them, you will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, all the wild animals of the earth, and the small animals that scurry along the ground. You will reign. That's kingdom language. Some translations say, you will have dominion. That's part of being made in the image of God. And if you've ever had a position of leadership, you know this is one of the hardest things in the world to do, is to lead people without violating the image of God in them. So when an authority figure uses power or fear tactics to control or manipulate other people, what that does is it violates the other person's kingdom. This is why when someone's violent, when someone physically hurts another person or takes advantage of them, it's just so offensive. Because what they're doing is they're infringing on the other person's territory. They're infringing on the other person's kingdom. Now, there's lots of different kingdoms that exist in our world. There are political kingdoms. There's entertainment kingdoms. There's religious kingdoms. There's corporate kingdoms. There's relational kingdoms. And if we were to take all of the kingdoms of this world, all the kingdoms that we're familiar with, and we were to condense it into one kingdom, it would be called the kingdom of earth. That would be it, the kingdom of earth. And we're very familiar with the kingdom of earth because this is where we live. But Jesus taught there is another domain. It's very real. It's very powerful. And Jesus referred to this domain as the kingdom of God. That's it. It's the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is wherever God's will is being done. The kingdom of God is wherever God's authority is more valued than human authority. It's where God's will is more prominent than human will. It's where what God wants done is done. And Jesus spends more time talking about the kingdom of God than anything else. And he says it's available to anyone. Matter of fact, in Matthew chapter 22, Jesus says the kingdom of God is like a feast, and it's a feast that everybody is invited to. Now, unfortunately, for whatever reason, many people tend to think of the kingdom of God as something that's available to the elite, as something that's available to the disciplined, as something that's available to the knowledgeable. It's something that's available to those who are good at keeping rules and they believe all the right things about God and they have all the right answers. Years ago, there was a very moving film that came out, a deeply theological movie. Some of you might remember this. It was called Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Now, if you actually liked the Monty Python movies, go ahead and put a thumbs up, put a heart, let us know it. Identify yourself because we want to make sure we get you the counseling you need. All right, this stuff came out in the 1970s. It was absolutely ridiculous humor. But this particular movie was about King Arthur and three of his knights who are in pursuit of something called the Holy Grail. But they have to get to the castle in order to get to the Holy Grail. And in order to get to the castle, they have to cross this big chasm, this canyon that thankfully has a bridge over it. It is called the Bridge of Death. And as they approach the Bridge of Death, they are met by a gatekeeper of sorts. He guards the bridge. He gets to determine whether or not someone goes over the bridge. And so he says to King Arthur and to his three knights, he says to them, I'm going to ask you three questions. If you get it correct, you cross the bridge. And if not, you are not crossing the bridge. You're going to be sent to your death. You're getting sent into the abyss. So the first knight steps forward and the person guarding this bridge asks, what is your name? Well, they give it. What is your quest? Well, I'm here in search of the Holy Grail. What is your favorite color? And he says, blue. And that's it. It's easy. He gets across the bridge. Well, then the second knight comes up and he's a little bit arrogant. He saw what happened. What is your name? Well, he gives it. What is your quest? Well, I'm in search of the Holy Grail. What is the capital of Assyria? And he kind of pauses. He says, well, I don't know. And so sure enough, he's sent into the abyss. Just ridiculous. Well, then this third knight comes forward. What is your name? So he gives it. What is your quest? Well, I am in search of the Holy Grail. And then what is your favorite color? Well, this knight is so shaken up from what he saw earlier. He says, well, blue. And then he realizes, no, it's yellow. It's yellow. And sure enough, he's sent into the abyss and there's an audible scream and it is absolutely ridiculous. And then King Arthur steps forward and somewhere in the questioning, he actually turns the question on the bridge keeper or the guy guarding the bridge. The guy doesn't know the answer. And so the guy guarding the bridge is sent into the abyss. Now, just stupid. But I know some people think we enter the kingdom of God if we can get all the right answers. It's actually not. We get into the kingdom of God when we acknowledge we don't have all the answers, that we're not qualified to be king of our life or king of our kingdom. The Apostle Paul actually talks about this. He writes a letter in the first century, and he talks about how God's kingdom isn't about a bunch of legalistic rules. It's not about what we eat. It's not about what we drink. But the kingdom of God is living a life of goodness and peace and joy. So imagine a society where there's no pride or arrogance, no big shots, just a spirit of servanthood and humility. Imagine a society where people are constantly on the lookout for anybody who might feel lonely or rejected, and they get included and celebrated and loved. Imagine a society where nobody does anything petty or small-minded, and there's no gossip, and there's no cruelty, and there's no fear. And watching over this society is a heavenly Father who is constantly being celebrated because of his infinite love. Jesus says, that's the kingdom of God. And it is very real, and it exists right now. But there's this other kingdom. It's the kingdom of earth. Now, I've got a question for you. How are things going in the kingdom of earth? Well, the answer is not so well, right? It doesn't matter what day you turn on the news. This has nothing to do with COVID-19. At any moment, you can turn on the news. You could have done this 6 months ago, 6 years ago, 60 years ago. And it's the same stories repeated over and over and over, right? Thousands of kids are dying every day when they don't need to. War is unfolding on different parts of our planet. The economy is always unpredictable, always up and down. Any day that you turn on the news, you'll see an imbalance of power. You'll see people who have a lot and those who have little. You'll see stories that reflect pain and bitterness and anxiety and jealousy. You'll see stories that reflect racism and sexism and prejudice. Those stories are repeated over and over and over. That is the kingdom of this earth. And Jesus said, I have a plan. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to bring the kingdom of God. I'm going to bring it down to earth. I'm gonna bring what's up here. Now, it's not physically in the sky somewhere, right? But it helps us understand. He says, I'm gonna bring up here, down here. Now, if you've got a piece of paper and a pen nearby, you might just wanna scribble out this little diagram, because this is such a powerful reminder. What God is constantly trying to do is to bring the kingdom of heaven down to the kingdom of earth, the kingdom of God down to the kingdom of earth. And in the most famous prayer he ever prayed, it's called the Lord's Prayer. The example of prayer that he set before his disciples, here's how Jesus starts the prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The model that Jesus gave his disciples for praying, quite honestly, sounds nothing like the way I pray, right? Because my prayers are all like, Jesus, fix my problems. Jesus, help my life be stress-free. Jesus, give me the strength to endure what I got to endure on this planet till I can finally be up in heaven with you, free from all the pain of this world. But the prayer that Jesus taught his followers to pray was that heaven would come down to us. He says, pray that God's kingdom would overtake our kingdoms, that God's kingdom would be integrated into our relational life and into our financial life and into our sex life and into our family life and into our parenting and into our careers. The kingdom of God is a way of life. So what would happen if the kingdom of God came down to earth? Well, we actually don't have to wonder, because this is exactly what Jesus did. He brought God's kingdom to this earth. Just look at the way he treated people. Look at the way he talked to people. Look at the way people were impacted when he served them. And the way the kingdom of God can be brought to earth in 2020 is by those who are his followers bringing it everywhere they go. It's by those who've decided, Jesus is gonna be the king of my life. I'm gonna be a part of his kingdom. It's for us to bring it everywhere we go. in the most famous talk Jesus ever gave. It's called the Sermon on the Mount. Here's how he puts it. He says, God blesses those who are poor and realize their need for him, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Some translations say that God blesses those who are poor in spirit. Now, in our culture, we don't typically associate the word blessed with the word poor, right? We associate the word blessed with the word rich. Like if you're in a rich person's house, right? If you go to a house that's huge and you're just kind of looking around and you're like, wow, this is a beautiful house. Nobody says, well, I have a lot of money. That's why, I'm very wealthy. No. What they'll do is they'll look at you and say, well, I'm really blessed, because we associate the word blessing with wealth. But the word blessed actually means happy. Jesus says, it's only when you're poor in spirit, it's only when you realize and recognize your need for God that you're able to discover true happiness. Now, don't miss this. We enter the kingdom of God when we realize I can't fix my life. I can't solve all my problems. I can't rescue myself from the things that I want to rescue myself from. And so I want Jesus to be king of my life. I want to enter his kingdom. And if you've never done that, I encourage you to do so. Right now, as a matter of fact, why don't you just pause and in your heart, just say, Heavenly Father, I want for Jesus to be king of my life. I want to become a part of Jesus' kingdom. Now, I'm guessing a lot of you have already done that. I'm guessing that you made that decision maybe years ago, maybe months ago. So let me ask you, how is Jesus being the king of your kingdom? How is it currently shaping your life? Because our life is constantly being shaped and formed on a regular basis, right? And naturally, we're going to be shaped by the kingdom of this earth, by the movies we watch, by the people we hang out with, by the environments that we're in. Naturally, we're going to be shaped by this if we aren't intentional about saying, God, I want your kingdom to shape me. But here's the deal. We are never going to be able to bring God's kingdom into the different environments we go if Jesus is not first and foremost king of our life, and the kingdom of God is not alive inside of us. So in order for that to happen, we have to get to a point where we truly surrender control. We say, Heavenly Father, I give you control. When's the last time you did that? When's the last time you say, I surrender my pride? I don't want to apologize to this person, but I'm going to apologize. When's the last time you surrendered maybe your time? Where you say, if I'm honest, I waste a lot of my time, but I want to surrender it to God. I want to use it in a meaningful way. One of the most difficult areas to surrender to God is to surrender our resources. To say, God, you're ultimately in charge of everything I have. I'm in your kingdom, so I want to use my resources to further your kingdom. And I got to tell you, right now, all across the world, businesses are being affected. Economies are impacted. Churches are being affected. In fact, at Great Lakes Church, our giving right now has been down roughly 25%. But let me tell you this. I am so proud of people who in this season have been stepping up. We've heard stories of people giving for the first time. They've been part of Great Lakes for years, but they're giving for the first time. We've heard of other people who are increasing the percentage of what they give. They're saying, God, in this difficult time, I want for you to be king in my life. I want to be a part of your kingdom. And so they live a surrendered life. I want to encourage you to be a part of that group. See, when God is in control and the kingdom of God is at work in our heart and our life, there's this overflow. And Jesus said, that's the way it should be. Jesus looks at his disciples and he says, let your good deeds shine out for all to see so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. Every time that you send an encouraging note to someone, you're bringing the kingdom of God. Every time you use your resources to be a blessing to people, every time you give to help further the cause of Jesus, you are bringing God's kingdom to this earth. Every time you choose to stop gossip in its tracks and you move towards being a peacemaker, you are bringing God's kingdom to this earth. Every time you walk with someone through an addiction and you help them to a place where they're finally breaking free, you're bringing God's kingdom to earth. Every time you sit with someone during a time of tragedy, you're bringing God's kingdom to this earth. Every time you speak life-giving words to your spouse, to your son, to your daughter, man, you are bringing God's kingdom to this earth. That is the gospel. That is the good news of Jesus. It's heaven breaking through into earth. One of my favorite songs comes out of a church in the Chicago area, and their music label is Community Music. And we've sung the song before. It's called When Heaven Breaks Through. Some of the lyrics are a little challenging to understand, but halfway through the song, here's what we read. All fear is broken. Truth will undo lies that were spoken when heaven breaks through. Joy overwhelming. Old is made new. Death lays defeated when heaven breaks through. If you are a follower of Jesus, my challenge to you is bring heaven everywhere you go. If you've been around for a while, you can start to feel like, Dave, I think this message is on repeat. You talk about this a lot. It is because it's so easy to gravitate from. It's so easy to get away from. It's so easy to think of the kingdom of God as what I believe and how I behave. No. This is about bringing God's kingdom and expanding it everywhere we go. The message of Jesus, the message of love, the message of hope, it is bringing God's kingdom down to this earth. Let me pray for you. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that we do not have to wait until we die and we go to this place up in the sky we call heaven, but that God, we have the opportunity to bring it everywhere we go. I pray do a work in us so that eventually you can do a work through us and we can be a part of expanding your kingdom. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thanks for joining us today. I hope you have a great week and I hope you bring God's kingdom everywhere you go.